Hey guys, what is going on? This is Virtual Riot and welcome to another episode of Studio Time with me. I know it has been a while, it took me so long to finally make another episode, but today we are going to be talking about my favorite synthesizer plugin since it came out. I think it's like almost over a year now. I'm talking about, let me just move myself into the corner down here. X-First Serum. I think I bought it a week after it came out, and it has been my favorite soft synth ever since. And today I want to give you the complete overview about all the things that you can do with it. I'm trying to get everything in there. I'm probably gonna forget something, but like we're gonna systematically go through this thing element by element, knob by knob. And yeah. That's the plan for today. I think this is going to take half an hour or something. This is going to be a long video. I'm going to make like little shortcuts in the description where you can jump to different parts. So we're going to be talking about the oscillators, the wavetable making stuff, filters, modulation. I don't know. I'm trying to organize this a bit. Yes, so the thing about Serum is people tend to call it Massive 2.0 sort of. And I think it's sort of right because of all the wavetable business. You have some factory wavetables, you can make your own ones, you can import some. There are free wavetables on the internet all over. You can create some really weird ones when you import your own samples and make wavetables from them and stuff. But then again, I'm still using Massive a lot. Because Serum is quite heavy on the CPU and the memory. So if I want to make something not as complexy, growly, or if I know I can realize it easily in Massive, then I'm gonna do the sound in Massive because I don't want my CPU to die all the time. But yeah, this is a powerful thing. Interestingly, I think a week later or 2 or 3 weeks after Serum came out, Waves released some VST plugin instrument called Codex that was basically a Serum ripoff, kinda. I don't know who had the idea first, but it was like, it has the same functionality with the wavetables, but you can't make your own. The modulation is completely horrible, and I don't know what they thought when they made that. So, as you can see, I downloaded a lot of additional wavetables. I made a lot by myself. If you search on the internet, you can even find the Massive wavetables for Serum, so you can use the Massive wavetables. Why not? So you can finally look what modern talking looks like. Nice. Oh yeah, so this is the first really nice feature. You can see your wavetables, and if you click them, you have either a 3D or a 2D view. And if you move through them, you see what happens with the wave. Just like in Massive, you have these warping modes where your waveform gets stretched or shrunk. So yeah, you have a lot of different warp modes like bend plus, bend minus, which are sort of the same as Massive. And in the 2D view, you can see what they do to your waveform, which is really nice. But you have a load of other stuff like sync, which makes a lot more sense when you use it with something like a saw wave, for example. It's amazing for making lead sounds or something. We'll come to that later. You have, furthermore, pulse width modulation, which sort of just adds emptiness to the end of your waveform. But that one is very useful when you're using square waves, again, for a Game Boy kind of sound. So if I got square waves. Yeah, modulating that would be a good choice here. We'll come to that later. And you've got even more weird modes. I'm just going to load some interesting waveforms so we can listen to all these interesting warp modes, like asymmetrical, plus and minus, which just shoves the waveform to a side. And you can already hear, like, from the initial wave that I have here. I mean, it sounds growly, But only this frame here doesn't sound particularly growly. But as soon as I use this warp mode, we got some yaw 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 going on there. I like that. You've got flip, which is just flips the waveform around. You've got mirror, which looks trippy as hell. I like that one. And then, besides FMing from the second oscillator, or ring modulating with the second oscillator, or amplitude modulating with the second oscillator, you can also draw your own warp methods. I think not a lot of people know about this feature. And I think it's one of my favorite features in Serum, aside from importing wavetables, because what you can do here is you can draw your own warp mode. So initially, what you will notice, the knobs don't do anything. And the wave doesn't do anything too. And then you can press this magnifying glass here, and up comes this window. And here you can add points and make a waveform like this. And this determines how your waveform will be warped. So now, this is basically something like, I think, bend minus. Bend minus does the same thing. Yeah. Let's go to remap. With the only difference that I can bring it even, I can take it even further by just changing the waveform in here. You can just leave this at 100% and then add points and move them around and see what happens with your waveform. I think if you move it up here, this is like asymmetrical because it shoves it to the side. This is like asymmetrical plus and minus, sort of. And then this is sort of a dry wet. So this the knob is always from here to whatever you've drawn. So you can go completely crazy here. You can even save these waveforms here, these shapes. It's in the same menu as your LFO shapes. So you can import LFO shapes in here and see what they do to your waveform. That is fun. I have literally totally messed up the waveform now. But yeah, limitless possibilities with this tool alone. Sort of. Of course, we can FM from B, so you gotta turn on B, turn down the level, and pitch it up maybe. And now we're FMing. Nice. Another cool thing is you have a dedicated sub-oscillator that you can route directly to the output. So if you're adding any effects over here, they're not going to affect the sub. Such a good feature. And you've got a bunch of waveforms to choose from. And you can also FM from the sub if you want, like FM sub-oscillator. Then you might want to turn down the level. And now we're getting FM from here. FM from everywhere. But of course, the most interesting part is importing your own samples in here to create wavetables. So there is this wavetable editing menu. If you press this button here, then you're in the wavetable editing menu. So down here you see the single frames that your wavetable consists of. And what Serum does, if you, for example, only got 4 or 5 frames, then you can crossfade between them. I'll show you in a second. So I made a bunch of wavetables myself, and they're all from wave files that I imported. I think you can drag and drop any wave file into this window. Actually, let's try that. So, for the sake of simplicity, we're gonna take a bass note from my sample pack or something. So I'm looking for a sample that really only plays one note, burp, and then just stops. So let's look for that. Single hit sounds, bass hits. This could be cool. Let's take that one. So let's drop it in here. And what appears? These are the different importing modes. They might look a bit weird to you at first. So this is Fast Frontier Transform, I think. Some sort of synthesis. I can't go into detail about this because I don't know enough about it. But yeah, this is interesting. You can just try them all out. These four at the bottom here are interesting. They're going to give cool results whatever you put in. Except if you put in silence, then nothing's going to happen, of course. But the most important, the most useful one is import with a constant frame size. So what it does is, if I'm going to do this, Oh, it even noticed the pitch of the sample. So nice. So what it does is it chops your wave file, whatever you put into it here, into a bunch of frames. So it's going to make a cut here, pretty much anywhere where there's zero crossing on the fundamental. And then it's going to put these into single frames in here. So sometimes it's going to mess it up and maybe it won't detect the pitch of your sample correctly, and it's going to slice it in the wrong size. So then you can go in here and import via fixed frame size, and then you can type in the number of samples that each frame has supposed to have. If you're confused by this, samples in this case means the number of steps in the waveform, one step in the waveform, because it's digital. Let me show you. Let me zoom in here. One step of this waveform. Okay, it's smoothed out. Initially, like in reality, because this is digital, these are steps. Like, it's quantized. Imagine this pixelated. So that's what audio on the computer, at least, usually looks like. And then Serum just goes step by step. And after you type in any amount of samples, so you type in 1,000 samples. So after 1,000 steps in here, Serum's gonna cut that, put it into one frame, and take the next 1,000 samples, put it into the next frame. That's how Serum makes wavetables in the fixed frame size mode. And there's the other modes, like dynamic pitch follow, where Serum tries to estimate the pitch of whatever you throw at it. But this worked out really nicely. So now there's a lot of silence at the end of this. So we're going to cut this away. I'm just going to select this one and say remove selected until end. So now we're only left with 20 waveforms. But it sounds quite chunky, steppy. So what we need to do is we gotta press morph, and now we can choose between crossfade, morph spectral, or morph spectral while zeroing the phase of the fundamental, which is sort of the best method, I think, according to Seamless. I trust him on this. I like to use crossfade too, but you can do anything. Since the fundamental is quite stable in here, I'm just gonna go with crossfade right now. And now we got frames between the frames. This number down here tells you how many frames you got in the current wavetable. So the maximum in Serum is 265. And before we did the crossfade, we only had 20. This heavily increases the size of the wavetable, but it makes it also sound a lot better. And we're going to go with the morph spectral and zero the fundamental phase. Yeah, this is a bit better. The crossfade had some little dips in the volume between each frame for some reason right now. Yeah, the first frame sounds a bit different because it's got this huge transient. This makes for a good single cycle wave. I don't even want to phase through the wavetable with this. I just want to use this nice crunchy wave and then maybe bend minus it or bend plus it. Yeah, this will work. Let's take Ben Plus. We can also modulate multiple things here. It's a bit messy. To make it less messy, I like to modulate the level of the oscillator as well. Let's turn up the speed of this a bit. Beautiful. So this is how you make a wavetable from anything that's tonal, but you can also throw in anything else. Some weird percussive noise sounds are quite interesting if you throw them at Serum. We're gonna do that now. So I'm gonna go in here and say import. We can drag and drop it too, but I wanna try both methods because I didn't know about the drag and drop actually. Willy from Barely Live showed me. And I was like, wow, this is possible. Amazing. So I've got some weird percussion sounds that I made. This one could be fun. So I'm just going to take that one and throw it in here. You can use these Fast Fourier Transform or Fast Frontier Transform. I forgot what FFT stood for. Anyway, you can try these. We can just throw it in here. And then we get a few interesting waveforms. So now what I would do is I would delete the rest and then just crossfade or morph between these. They sound interesting. They can be, especially if you've got screechy content like this. This is going to sound interesting with bent minus. And if you add a sub. Or bent plus. Yeah, much better with bent plus. So screechy content like that can be cool if you choose the right warp method. But I want to try out the other way of saying import via fixed frame size. And then I'm going to go into the folder. Which one did I take? 18. So percussion layered, 18. And now I can type in the number of samples that each frame is supposed to have. And I'm just going to type in 1,000 or something. Say OK. Nice, that's something I expected, like something like this. So this here, as you see, if you don't look at the single frames but at the whole thing, this is the sample initially. If I'm gonna drag and drop it in here, it's just gonna look the same. So this is a nice visualization of how these frames are created. Yeah, so this is exactly the same thing. Now I'm gonna clean this up. This is sort of the last frame that has any value in terms of sound. There's almost nothing, so I'm just going to delete everything. Then you've got a bunch of methods here to mess with your wave, with your single frames, actually. So what I want is, because it goes very silent here, these are quite quiet, I can say process and I can normalize each frame. So now each frame is at its maximum volume. I can also smooth out the corners, the edges a bit, with X fade edges. Sometimes that helps, especially if you want to import something like an analog pluck, saw pluck filter, whatever, something that's supposed to sound very smooth. And then you've got these weird artifacts on the edges. That's what that is useful for. And then I'm going to morph again. Zero, the fundamental. And there we go. That is a sick wavetable, actually. And then I would just press save and save this to my wavetable library. You can create infinite folders. I think you can even create subfolders by now, since some of the latest updates made that available. And then you can create your own huge wavetable library. I personally took all the wavetables from Omnisphere 2, because Omnisphere 2 has wavetables now, and I converted them for Serum, sort of. In like a session that only took me 6 hours. I don't know. I was bored. But now I got all the Omnisphere wavetables in here. Why not? Some of them are really interesting. So some off dissonant stuff there, which is very useful. I really like this waveform by itself. So, since we have explored making your own wavetables and all the warp modes, we can now continue to the filter after I am. Oh yeah, we also have like multiple voices and detune, but that's only. Of course, we have that, which is great if you want to make a huge stack of saws or something. Oh, a side note on this, what you might don't know, you can see the distribution of the voices here. Like, now they're all at the same pitch, and this is how they spread, some pitch down, some pitch upwards. But on the global tab up here, you can change the way these voices are being pitched. So it's down here at unison, mode, linear, then you can change it to, for example, super. And now you only have a few voices that are pitched quite a lot up and down, and more voices around the middle section. So you've only got a few very detuned ones. This sort of changes the character a bit. You can even go further than one called exponential. Or inverse, then you've got a bunch, then you've got a lot on the outside. Or random, and then it's just gonna be all over the place. because why not? And if you want to restart your phase, like have your waveform start at the same phase every time, then you can do that with these two knobs, because this random knob determines in what area the phase of the wave is always starting. This is, you can imagine this like the restart via gate button in Massive. Oh yeah, and if you have if you've got multiple detuned voices going on, they're all gonna start at the same phase, so they're gonna drift apart like this, which can be a cool effect sometimes. What was the waveform I liked? This was cool. So we got the sub on. Now we can continue to the. We got a bunch of filter shapes here. Low passes, high passes, band passes, peaks, and notches. Which aren't that strong. There we go. Then you've got some multi-filters, which are multiple filters at once. For example, one of my favorites, the high pass and peak. So this is a high pass and a peak filter. So just imagine it like the all pass from Massive, both together. And what you can do, you can modulate them into different directions, for example. This is quite vowel-y already, so I can take this LFO to modulate this one upwards. While the other one goes downwards. A little bit like the band reject in Massive, where you have that dip and the two bumps right next to it, and then they just move towards each other. And then the position of the all pass or of the peak here kind of determines the vowel a bit. Like that. I want a little bit of motion over here as well. This is cool. But aside from that, you also have filters that morph from one state into another. For example, this one goes from low pass to band pass to high pass with a 24 pole. So now it's a low pass, band pass, now it's a high pass. Another interesting thing, if you click it, you will see what it does to your phases. Might not be interesting to all of you, but yeah, to the absolute audiophile engineer producing nerds, this can be interesting to look at. Especially if you morph through the filters, it just goes bananas. So, next up, you've got comb filters, flangers, and phases. I really like this because here you can, it's not like you're stuck with an effect with, like, usually you know a flanger or a phaser as an insert effect that you put behind your Massive or whatever, and then it flanges already or it phases already, and it has this movement that you can only like set the speed of how fast it flanges or how fast the phaser poles are moving around. But here you have them as filter shapes and you determine what they do. Really like that. So I can have this phaser move together with my wavetable over here. You've got a lot of different phasers with amount of notches. You've got flangers, flanger high pass mixtures again. Positive flangers, negative flangers. Positive comb filters and negative comb filters. This would be a positive one. This would be a negative one. Negative one sounds more squarey because it has the uneven overtones. I actually like this a lot. Ooh. Another cool thing here is I'm just gonna save this real quick because I want to go back to this later. Positive flanger madness. So if I mess this up, I have something to go back to later. Interesting here is that you've got this pan knob, and what it does is it creates a different cutoff position for your left and your right channel. It's sort of, imagine if the cutoff is at 12 o'clock, it sort of moves it to 1 o'clock and 11 o'clock for your left and right channels. So if you've got something like the flanger, which has a way different sound if you only move the cutoff slightly, it's gonna make your sound super stereo wide. I hope you can hear this. If you've got headphones on, you're definitely gonna hear this. This will be fun. Works with the flanger too. And then you can even modulate this. This is like modulating the cutoff for left and right independently. Nah, not independently, but you get what I mean. And then you got like drive parameters and that kind of stuff down here sometimes. And in the miscellaneous section, you have some interesting things. For example, sample and hold is a bit crusher, sort of, and sample and hold. So if you want to bit crush your sound, if you've got a sine wave, a cute sine plug or something, and you want it to be bit crushed, then choose the sample and hold. And then I think the cutoff. Nope, not the cutoff. Oh, yeah. I forgot. Oscillator B doesn't go through the filter as long as this button isn't on. So yeah, the cutoff is the sample and hold. Beautiful. I'm gonna take something different. So yeah. This is your sample and hold, and then the resonance is a bit crusher. Beautiful. So yeah, that's hidden in there. And there's also a bunch of really weird filters. For example, this filter called reverb. And I think what it does is it is the impulse response, maybe? It looks like some convolution shape impulse response thing, I don't know, of a reverb. Used as a filter shape, and because it is so weirdly detailed, complicated, like it's got all these ups and downs and it's totally messing up your phase. Sounds super weird, but I love it. Reset this real quick. And because it messes so much with your phases here, it even changes the pitch if you move the cutoff. So down here, like all the way down and with the resonance cranked quite up, it even sounds like some sort of metallic reverb. Yeah, maybe there's some sort of impulse response there. Yeah, but be careful when you're gonna modulate it. Because yeah, it deflects the sound so much and it's gonna mess up your pitch and everything. But in certain situations, this can be an amazing filter. Also, the pan knob is good on this one because wow, it makes it super wide. It also messes up your phase, but who cares if it's super wide now? So yeah, crazy, crazy filter. And then you've got Forman filters. Oh yeah, oh yeah. Yeah, yeah. So if you want some kind of Daft Punky lead sound, I'd suggest you take a saw wave. And then maybe modulate this with a very slow LFO. That's not gonna And then in the effects section, we can maybe add some distortion on this. I'm gonna put it on mono and legato, so beautiful. A bit like the energy drink intro bass, but that one, I think I don't know if I used a Forman filter like this for it. I can still play it. Nice. So yeah, that's a cool filter as well to have. And down here is a band redirect. This one was recently added with an update. I'm so happy to see that Steve Duda, who made this plugin from the label Xfer, is still updating this thing very often, and he even added some new features like this filter. I hope there are going to be more filter shapes in the future or something. It's really cool to see a plugin getting more filter shapes. I don't know if that ever happened with any other plugin in the history of time. So yeah, there's a band reject here. And that one is mighty. I really like it. So for proper yawing, we're just gonna add this here maybe. Yeah, why not? And you've also got a mix, a dry wet. Sort of. Which can be handy too. So that is the filter section, and now we're gonna move on to the effect section. To have a transition from the filters, like, you've got another filter in here. So just to start with that, you can, if you want another filter, you have one in here with the exact same filter shapes, the exact same knobs. They're running in serial mode, you can't run them in parallel mode. But you've got another filter in here. So in the effects section, you have, I think 10? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 10 different effects, which are, for example, yeah, let's just start at the top. This is some sort of chorus, unison thing. I think generally it just makes your sound very much, much more wider. And while not messing with your mid signal, I hope. I really like it, because it's like a smart chorus, sort of. You can mix it in. I really like just mixing it in like this. And this over here is the dimension expander. From Massive, sort of. Yeah, I like to mix that in too. Just to give the whole sound some room and some wideness as soon as it goes up. So it sort of goes from mono to stereo, sort of. So yeah, then it's the filter. Then there's distortion. Different types of distortion. Soft clip, tube distortion. Interestingly, you can, again, draw your own distortion style, I think. Wave shaping style. So this has a wave shaper. And then I can, like, I think if I do something like this here. Yeah. This is gonna happen. I don't know enough about this to talk about this, but yeah, like, this shapes your wave. And this is gonna distort your stuff. Seamless had a bunch of tutorials, a bunch of how-to basses, where he used wave shapers excessively to manipulate his bass sounds. Go over there and learn from him about wave shaping. If I'm gonna try to explain it now, I'm gonna get it wrong. There's a flanger with the amazing feature to turn it off. I mean the rate. So it's not moving anymore, because initially it's like all over the place, but you can just turn the rate down and it's stopped. And then you can choose a position where it's supposed to just stay. And if you've got some screechy place like this, you can mix it in maybe like this with a dry and wet. I'm just gonna leave it like this right now. I'm also gonna use the distortion. I mean, while we're at it, we can also make a sound. Why not? Nice. Next up, the phaser. One of my favorites. You can also turn it off. So it doesn't move anymore. Or you can sync it to your host tempo. Very useful if you want to be snails. So, yeah, you see why I like it. If you stop it and then you just move it to the right position, it adds some growliness, and we're just gonna mix it in too. Yeah, a bit more. Then there's a chorus. You can also stop. Yeah, you can mess around with this a bit. I don't want to mess it up too much. There's a delay with a built-in filter, and you can choose different times for left and right. I like to use 2/8 notes and one is dotted. So for like plucky, melodic, dreamy things, this is a good delay way to do your delay. You've got ping pong, you've got tap delay. Got like different modes there. Then you've got a compressor. The most amazing thing about Serum, because you can put it on multiband mode, and then it's pretty much an OTT. If you don't know what an OTT is, that is a compressor from Ableton. It's this thing here, this multiband compressor from Ableton, and this down here looks like this. So I guess there's a built-in OTT. Yes. And it just compresses the heck out of your sound. It generally gives you some sort of more high frequency content and makes everything quite equal and brick walled. But a reverb that sounds very metallic-y, but it can be cool sometimes. Also, changing, like you can drag and drop these to change the order. And if you've got the OTT compressor going on here, the multiband, and then you take the reverb and put it in front of the compressor, this is what happens. Your reverb gets blown up all over the place. Which can be cool. It also works with the delay. So after the compressor, it sounds like this. Oh, we didn't even hear it because of the reverb. And before the compressor, it sounds like this. Which is cool too, because it gets sort of distorted. It's way longer, of course, because the multiband compressor pushes up everything that's very quiet and like makes it a lot louder. So yeah, that's the thing. And there's an equalizer with two bands, sort of. So you can have two peaks or two shelves, or one shelf and one peak. You can like choose between shelf, peak, and cut. And I like to use this one a lot as a sort of an additional filter, because for example, I don't, like, this is not sweeping enough for me in the lower end. I'm just gonna take this and modulate the frequency here. And then I might use the other one to cut something away. And trying to find the sweet spots. I might even mix it in this way. So this doesn't bring up too much of the lows, but only of the mids here. Nice. So yeah, that's the effects section. We've used quite a bit now. I might want to turn off the flanger. Oh, was the flanger cool? Well, I only did that. Very annoying. I really like this. Oh, it sounds a bit standard. This is a bit more like it. Maybe we can FM it. Let's just try that real quick. So, by the way, if you want basic waveforms really quick, you just go to analog, which is a factory wavetable section. Then you just go on basic shapes, and that's where you got everything you need. You've got sine wave, a saw wave, a triangle wave, some square waves with different pulse widths, and a square saw mixture thing. I don't know. Don't know what that is, but it sounds cool. That's what it sounds like. Sounds like a saw plus a square or something. I don't know. So I'm gonna use maybe a triangle wave and turn this one down. And then I'm just gonna FM from over here. Beautiful. A thing I like to do, I mean, this is a quite a messy waveform right now. Maybe not the best waveform to be FM'd. But this is fun. What I like to do sometimes is go in here and there's another thing about the wavetable editor I forgot. So if you've got this one selected here, for example, the sine wave, you can click this arrow, and then up here, like in Citrus or in Hummer, you have the overtone spectrum of that waveform. And now you can just add overtones and change the phase down here. So if I just got the sine wave, I can add overtones to mess up the FM, because why not? Why not? This is cool. Why not? So next up is modulation. As you might have seen, I've already been doing it a bit. You can just drag and drop from these LFO tabs and just drop modulations on any knob that you like. And by right-clicking the knob, you can remove either the currently selected one. So if I got the second LFO on the pan as well. And if I right-click it now, I can just remove LFO2 because I got it selected currently, or I can remove all modulations. If I just want to remove LFO1 now, I've got to select LFO1 first and then right-click the knob. And then I can just remove LFO1, or I can just bypass it. Okay, got removed it now, or you can just remove all modulations and then this little thing that's going to disappear. Also, you can only see the modulations of the currently selected LFO or envelope. So this is turning gray. You can still see the moving, but you can only see what LFO1 is really doing when you've got it selected. So yeah, that's sort of your different layers of automation there. You can also, if you're a super nerd, you can go into the modulation matrix over here. A thing why I hated Waves Codecs, because it only had this modulation matrix, I think. I don't want to say anything wrong here. So, and here you've got these beautiful lines that show you what is being modulated by what. So basically LFO1 is doing everything right now. And then if you want, you can add in an auxiliary source here. Auxiliary source here. For example, why am I modulating here? I think, yeah, this is the filter width right now. So you can either dial this in to change the strength. As you see, it's not being modulated now. Is at half the strength now, and is at maximum now. So you can put in something here, like a macro. There's these four macros on the side. They can also do anything else. They can also like just move a cutoff up and down, of course. But you can also instead of just right clicking here and removing the macro, you can also right click over here at the macro and say, just remove all destinations. Don't modulate anything. I really liked what this did. Like, I'd want this to change on every warp. So what I can do is, I can use LFO2. And now LFO2 is responsible for the modulation strength of the filter width down here. So if I just turn it all the way down, nothing's gonna happen. If I turn it all the way up, 100% modulation. So now I can just make a shape like this. Now it's gonna go from 100% to 0%. I want it to go from 100 to 50. Nice, that's what I want. Also, your LFOs initially don't start, like they are synced to your host tempo, but they don't start when you press your key. You gotta change it to trigger mode. I'm gonna do it for both now because I'm using both. Now the LFO starts when you hit your key. You also got the envelope mode, which just triggers the envelope once. The LFO once. Ah, I said envelope there. because then it behaves like an envelope. I'm not even using envelope 2 or 3 over here anymore. Envelope 1 is, by default, your volume envelope. The speed of your LFO can be changed here. And you can also access triplets and dotted notes by turning these on here. Yes. I want this. I also want this for the sub. This is a bit better, a bit more relaxed. Also, this is a nice place. All right. Next up, you can also modulate. You can also modulate with the velocity. So I'm just gonna. What am I gonna do? I'm gonna put this on the cutoff. Why not? And then you can see here how what the input value for the velocity is. And you can change the mapping sort of here, like so. Now it's going to be at 100%, except for some very, very softly played notes. And you can do the same for the key tracking. And you can apply that to, for example, the wavetable position. That's interesting. So if I play down here, it's a different wavetable position as if I play up here. Doesn't sound that different right now. But if I add points here to create a huge difference between a few semitones, I can make these four notes sound a lot different now. So yeah, these are interesting modulators. At the same time, there are some modulators that are hidden. They're not down here in this menu. You see, modulation is a huge topic, but some just show up only if you right-click. So what I'm doing here is I'm going to right-click the wavetable position and go on mod source. And for example, you have note on random, and this is going to be a random value between 0 and 100% on every keystroke, on every note. Sad thing is you don't see it, you have to go into the modulation matrix, but it's going to be there. It's going to be note on random on wavetable position and all the way up. So now it's going to be from here to here. It's still moving because of my LFO. It's at a different position every time I press a key. I'm just going to save this real quick, because this feature, this random, can be very interesting if you have a melodic sound going on. And you have a waveform like, what are we going to do? I think I have a waveform something like this. This is a bunch of analog waveforms with crossfades for some reason. I don't know why. I wouldn't want crossfades there, but never mind. What I can do is, if I now use the note on random, just going to check if it's on 100%. Yes. You can also follow it here. It's jumping to a different value every time. And if I now, for example, have a pluck going on with this LFO here on trigger mode, it's gonna take a filter with a steeper curve. And now I'm gonna have a different timbre. Is that the right way to pronounce it? A different character to every note, because using a different waveform. To make this visually even more tripping, I can use bend plus and link it to the filter curve. Oh yeah, I only want this on envelope mode. And now we can make this a little bit more beautiful by adding delay and compressors and all that nice gear. Why can't I hear delay? There we go. A bit too fast. Yes. Did I add distortion? I don't want distortion. You can also add the same note on random to the bent minus. So now, as you see, it's the same random position for both every time. But if you want two different random values, you have the note on random too, which is a different random value. You only have these two. You don't have more than that. But for all your crazy modulations, this should be enough, I think. You also have, what else do you have? You can modulate something with the noise oscillator over here, which is a bunch of samples that you can add. It's like the noise oscillator in Massive, but you can add in your own wave files to be triggered or to be even key tracked if it's something tonal. Gonna come to that later. So yeah, you have that too. You also have the chaos modulator that you can't find anywhere else except for in this menu or in this menu over here. You got the same modulation sources here as in the right-click menu. And what that is, it is a constantly changing random value. It's like a smoothed out sample and hold generator, sorta. So I'm just gonna take that and use it for the cutoff. It's randomly changing the cutoff. It's the same kind of chaos every time, but you can change the chaos rate over here. Yeah, you can even make it an actual sample and hold, like make it step. This is sick. I didn't know that. That's cool. So you can use this very efficiently to, for example, take the, yeah, sync this. Eighth notes, maybe? No, let's take 16th note. Then, while this is being modulated with these 16th notes, I am gonna modulate this again with this LFO, having it on trigger and on 16th. So now this is like a random pattern of 16th notes with different velocities. It feels like different velocities, but it's only this random step generator now. And now if I use the same thing for this huge wavetable of different waveforms, this is gonna be fun. It's gonna just choose a different waveform for every stroke, sort of. It kind of sounds like some weird guitar picking. I think that is most there is to modulation in Serum. Let's get back on an init preset. Oh my god, this has been going on for an hour almost, isn't it? Oh, shoot. The noise oscillator over here comes with a bunch of factory noises, which is like white noise that can pitch up and down, or tonal, or like attacks. Or there's like claps. This is an attack, but it's being looped. You can turn it off here. So if you have a plucky sound, this can add to the pluckiness. We've got something like this. This can add to the attack. You can even make it key track so that it pitches up and down with the notes you're playing. So if I turn off the oscillator, there it is. There's also some tonal things, like there is a glass hit here, which can be a fun addition. You can also have it run through the filter. So this can make your sound a bit more organic by adding some interesting samples. You can also put in your own folders, add your own samples. I added a bunch of samples already. I've got these tonal sort of hits. Sounds a bit like... yeah. But you can add in anything here. This is a lot of fun. I used most of these pans and pot hits. Which work great for bass, housey, stabby basses, for example. Oh, we can make one real quick. I made a few wavetables that are very useful for bass house plucks, plucky basses. So I'm just gonna use this one, go from beginning to end, use the sub, Luke. Can use the second one to maybe add a fifth on top, send it through the filter. Maybe detune this a bit. Maybe even detune this one. Now add the bell. Either run the bell through the filter with this button, or we could just modulate the level. Yeah, this is fun. I'm getting carried away again. So let's finish this off with, for example, the squarify mode. That is, if you've got a wavetable. Anyway, let's take one of the standard factory wavetables. One where there's a little bit more happening, maybe. Oh, let's go into the spectral menu. And let's choose one where there's some stuff going on. For example, that one. That one was made by Seamless. Then you can go into the wavetable edit menu, and down here is this little tiny button. If you click on it, there's the menu, singles and multis. And if you go on multis, there is process squarify. What this does is, it uses a formula to remove every even harmonic from your wave, from each frame, only leaves you the odd harmonics. So it sounds like a square wave now. It also makes it a bit more quiet, so we gotta normalize each frame again. And now, sounds like Terror Squad. And now it's very useful for FMing. I'm just gonna FM from B. Use a saw wave, have the level turned down. Maybe modulate the level, add a sub. I'm doing this with my left hand while the right hand is on the keyboard. This is so hard. Turn on the filter, use the high pass peak. There you go, rhythm. Not even rhythm, so there's more. Add some effects. Done. Another cool trick that I use very often is modulating the pitch of everything at the same time. Which is sort of hard, because how do you want to modulate the pitch of the sub, for example? You can't really drag something on the octave here, and even if you could only modulate it up and down in octaves. That's a bit weird, you don't want that. So what you got to do is you got to go into the modulation matrix, and as a modulation source we're going to use LFO2, and as the destination we take global master tune. And then you got to turn it up. So now this is modulating the master tune. I'm just going to put it on trigger mode. And this is bipolar, so the middle is the original pitch, and above this line is pitch it up, and below this line is pitch it down. So this, I'm playing an F now, so this goes down from an F to whatever. And that's sort of a key element of the warm-up space, actually, where it does this while at the same time doing something like... No. Yeah, it sort of goes into the direction. Another thing I really like to do is using different LFOs to modulate different things and having them at different speeds or shapes. For example, if I have something like... I'm just gonna take one of my... No, this is a bit weird. I'm just gonna take one of my wavetables here. Which one is cool? Yeah, this one is nice. For example, if I want to make it wobble, I would use LFO1, for example, to modulate a filter like this. And also to modulate the volume of the sub and the oscillator. I'm just going to turn this up to make it sound a bit better. But then, instead of using the same LFO to modulate the wavetable position, I might use LFO2 at the same speed, but use it in a saw wave form. So this is scanning along a path of the wavetable while the filter opens and closes. So it has a bit more motion to it, instead of just going back and forth. It sounds different in the roll-off than in the attack this way. Really depends on the wavetable though. The Omnisphere Bell ones are really nice for this. Because then you have this whole sweep with all the weird overtones going on. Which is just amazing. I might even want to modulate this. Then we can put some distortion on this. Yes. And also, the next thing, using different LFO speeds. Right now, they're both running at the same speed, but yeah, if I double the tempo of this one, the first wob is in the first half of the wavetable, and the second wob is in the second half of the wavetable. I can also switch this around. I might put both on trigger mode. Yeah! I can even turn this up more, and then we got... So yeah, this can be useful. I think I used something like this in my preset pack that I put out for Serum already, where it's like... Where is it? Oh, come on. There's the bass called Two Stages. That has this modulation at half the speed. So, oh, well, they're running at the same speed, but I've got two wobs in here. At different heights is cool too, because then you got like a different vibe to it. In this case, this is also using a squarified wavetable. My favorite moves there. So yeah, that was a lot about Serum now. I'm just gonna show you some cool presets I made for the end. I made some growls. Maybe they're gonna be out in some preset pack, who knows. But they are not available yet. I also assigned some of the macros here. I also got some Jack U sound. In this case, using the reverb filter, which is making it nice and messy, I like that. Or I got this one. Oh wait, that's too deep. I used that preset in the what was it? Beyond in the track, Beyond. And these are all wavetables that I made myself from importing samples. You can really import anything. I imported some Vengeance vocals. Or... Sounds funny. Or some Vengeance vocal where it says, on the floor. And then you just got like... And if you sweep through it like this, you can... add interesting effects to it with the warp modes now. So if you import samples in the right way in here, you can mangle little bits of speech or a sentence or a word or something. Speaking of mangling words, there's a built-in text-to-speech engine in Serum, but it's a bit chunky, but it's fun. If you type in something down here in quotes, like Virtual Riot, and press enter, then it's gonna use some computery voice wave table. Yeah, sorta. Oh, I have been minus on it. Doesn't make it better. You can sorta guess it. But it's a nice idea. Virtual works. But yeah, that's a nice tiny, like, it's almost like an Easter egg. Yes, that sound is called Fart Champion. I got a tip for all the Windows users. There is a program called Serum FM Wavetable Studio that is free to download. It's for Windows only, and it's like a standalone tiny program where you can make your own wavetables that use FM. You can just like stack waveforms and say like FM from the beginning of the waveform till the end of the waveform, like FM from 0% to 100%, and then this thing creates wavetables for you. And I used it, and they are really nice. For example, this one. This is just a bunch of square waves FMing each other. It sounds sick as hell already. It's only from that wavetable plugin. Or this is a bunch of saws FMing themselves. Also, it looks beautifully symmetrical. This is some saws FMing a sine wave, which sounds super rhythmy. This is some more squares. This is some saws FMing a triangle wave, which is also super rhythmy. Yeah. If you want to go super rhythmy, this is the way to do it. But yeah, that is a cool program. I can't show it right now because I only have it on my laptop. Aside from growls and basses, you can also make lead synths. So what we're gonna do for that real quick is turn up the voices to 16, monophonic, legato, turn on some portamento. What we can do then is modulate this and put it on sync and modulate it quite slow. And I'm just gonna add some effects over here, maybe compress it, put some delay on it, all the good things. Yeah, good lead sounds are possible with this thing as well. I'm just gonna turn the detune really low. Or maybe even add another saw an octave higher. gets a bit more future bassy now. And maybe we could add as a filter a flanger now, slowly phase it up and down or something. That sounds a bit cheesy. Or use the formant. Why not? Because it is so funny. Nice. Endless possibilities with this thing. So I hope you enjoyed this. If you have Serum, try importing everything as wavetables. You can never have enough wavetables. I have like all of these are self-made from other samples that I imported. Like these are some citrus growls and stuff. Sounds like citrus. Or these are some percussions. Again. Hence, you can use anything and make a good sound out of it somehow in this with all the tools you have here. So I think this is it now. This is all I have to say about Serum for the moment. Thank you for watching. I hope this hasn't been too long. If you've got any questions to any details about Serum, then post it in the comments. I will read it. I will answer. And I think next time we're going to talk about effects to put on Serum then later on, like effect chains, post-processing and stuff, layering. Maybe that could be cool because like this has all just been in the box inside of Serum now, but most of the sound design can happen through additional effects and everything. So that would be an interesting topic to talk about, and mixing in general would be interesting. So yeah, if you've got anything you want to know about, any other things you want me to talk about in a year when I'm going to upload the next episode, sort of, then just post it in the comments. And yeah, I'm happy for any type of feedback. All right, so goodbye. Have a good rest of the year.